Welcome to the Andy Social Podcast. My name is Andy, surprise, surprise, and a big welcome to everybody that's downloading, streaming, whatever the hell you're doing to listen to this episode. A big thank you for the long-time listeners that are here, the faithful, every episode, every week, and also anybody that's tuning in for the first time. Hopefully this will be the introduction to a longer relationship together that you'll tune in for future episodes and even go back and listen to some of the ones that have been in the past, because it's been one hell of a ride in such a short period of time, and it's continuing to get bigger and better. And this week is absolutely no exception. And I shouldn't say this week, because I've started up the ante with the episodes as well. So for this episode, it gets bigger and better. It features Steve Bull. Steve is best known for being the bass player in the Australian iconic band Ice House. A bit of a fanboy moment for me to talk to Steve. And Steve also is a head teacher at WSI Entertainment, the Western Sydney Institute, which is sort of a TAFE-based thing that, and I'm going to completely butcher the description of this, but offer courses for students to upskill them in the music industry in a whole range of facets in different areas. So it's a very important area of development and a very important part of the music industry to ensure longevity and, I guess, best practices and quality continue to come out of this country, because we've certainly got a great reputation in the international scene. And from all aspects, whether it be performance or production or anything of the sort. Things that Steve is doing through these courses and whatnot are certainly helping to ensure that this is going to be a long-term thing with the next generation of people coming through. So the majority of this conversation is penned around that. We talk about the stigmas attached with the music industry, perceptions of what the music industry is, some of the myths that a lot of young people have when they first start the course versus when they leave, a lot of the do's and don'ts. And we talk about a lot of the basics that people tend to forget or get sidetracked in. I think we get swept up in the romantic sense of what working in the industry is all about, being whether it be a musician or a producer or sound engineer or lighting guy or whatever it might be. There's a certain amount of fantasy attached to it, which is not always the reality. And I think a big takeaway, if anything, to take away from this conversation is really sort of looking at taking on responsibility of your career and your future. And being in the music industry, you really need to have those skills to have the responsibility to be empowered yourself and not have to rely on other people or a structure that sort of holds your hand along the way. The music industry can be cutthroat, but it's extremely rewarding, and it's very much, in a lot of ways, very freelance-based. So the onus is on you to succeed and to find your path. And I mean, that's like anything in life for the most part, but the music industry is a unique industry in itself. And we highlight that quite a bit throughout the conversation. We also speak a little bit about songwriting. Steve has about 250 songs penned to his name, whether it be complete songwriting credits or co-writing or whatnot. So we touch a bit on that and the challenges and different experiences of going through the songwriting process and also being contracted to a major label as well. Steve was contracted through Sony for a number of years, going back a little while now. So just we talk a little bit about those times and then in a general sense about songwriting itself. So it's a lot of interesting things that we touch on. So if you're a musician or somebody that's very much interested in the music industry, this is a fantastic episode to tune into. Even if you're just a music fan or just somebody that's interested in a different perspective of life, as always, these episodes are beneficial for everybody. It's not just a particular niche. And then lastly, right at the end, of course, I couldn't let Steve get away without talking about Ice House. So we touched on a bit about Ice House and how the band's functioning now and moving forward. And I make a mention of when I saw Ice House about a year ago and how amazed I was at the level of musicianship in that band. It certainly set a benchmark for me of what I think a band should be. They're one of the greatest in the country, and one of the greatest shows that I've ever seen myself personally. So I think one thing just to say on that note is there will be a number of people that tune into this podcast that will maybe know of Icehouse or know Icehouse through the late 80s hits. I really encourage you guys to go and have a listen a bit deeper into the catalogue, and I'll put a few links on andysocial.net so you can discover Icehouse, because they are an iconic band and an amazing band with a large list of fantastic songs over the years. And if you've never heard Icehouse, then I'll certainly put a number of links in there for your benefit as well. But I'm a huge fanboy of the band, and it was great to have a chat with Steve, and hopefully you won't be the last one. So anyway, enough rambling. Please enjoy this conversation with Steve.
Andy, how are you?
Yeah, very well yourself.
Not bad.
There's a few things I want to chat to you about, and you came through as a recommendation from a couple of people that you know, that we both know, and Jerry and Andrew.
Andrew.
Hansen.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Cool.
So
Good fellas.
yeah, definitely. And I'm a bit of an Icehouse fanboy to a degree as well. So I thought, oh, this all sort of ticks a few boxes. So I might have a chat to you. But there's quite a few different angles and different things I wanted to chat to you about. But a lot of it was
Sure.
probably around what you do as a profession, as a teacher, and working at WSI, and probably a bit more of your firsthand experience with what you teach, and probably the experiences or things that you see from students who do come through the ranks when they come in and when they leave. Because a lot of the people that listen to this are not just music fans, but they're also budding musicians or people that are slightly established and are out there, but are always looking for a new perspective on things. So it's just a bit of an eye opener, and then we just go off on a tangent if need be. But that's sort of where my
Sure.
mind's at with it all. But do you want to just, I guess, for people who don't know who you are, do you want to just give a very brief outro, or not an outro, an intro of who you are?
Well, my name's Steve Bull. I'm a Sagittarian. I suppose I've been playing music for about 30 years now. Started on piano because my parents made me fell in love with music when I stopped learning the piano. And my dad had a chord book on the piano, and I started playing these chords and went, oh, wow, that's really cool. Let's put that one next to that one. Finished school, went on and did a diploma, a Bachelor of Music at Sydney Uni. So I studied with a guy called Peter Sculthorpe, among others. And that was the goal. My parents thought I should have a fallback position. I tried to get into the jazz course at the Con, but I think I came third out of that. It took two in North Sydney. I came third or something. But basically, just been mostly playing bass for other people for money. Now, that sounds mercenary, but it's not really supposed to. It's kind of like, I love to play music and I want to do it for a job. I certainly dabbled. I had a couple of original bands for years, and kind of one of them almost got signed to Sony, but didn't quite. And then a kid, young Sebastian, and that changes your perspective a bit. So it became like, well, I really need to, if I'm going to keep playing music, be more kind of a professional about it. Not that I wasn't before, but you just have to make a living. So I'm basically working for other people, but most of the time, and I can say this honestly, most of the time I play with people I really like and play music I really like. And a lot of that has been playing in original bands with other people, if that makes sense. Like, playing, and that was usually the stuff I did for next to nothing, original artists who were trying to do something with their music, and I feel very supportive of that. So I'd go and do that as much as I could. And then I started at TAFE in 2000. Amongst all of that, I kind of toured, did 9 years running music programs for disadvantaged young folk, or they became marginalized youth, and then they were disadvantaged youth. It was a program called Creative Youth Initiatives. So that was like a kind of part-time job. And we just like made records with them, which is pretty cool. But then I kind of left that and started TAFE. And I've kind of been balancing gigging, writing, producing ever since. Is that
So,
brief enough?
yeah, absolutely. No, that's good. And I mean, I did a bit of stalking online, just via the extensive Google search, just to get a bit of an
As
idea.
you should.
Yeah. And I mean, what you said is definitely brief because there's been a whole heap of things you've been doing over the years. And it's quite fascinating, really, because one thing that poked out straight away is probably the songwriting aspect and the amount of songs that you've contributed to or solely written over the years. And I think from what I understand, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, a lot of those songs, like you were working for Sony as a song, as a songwriter. It was that, does that make, is that
Yeah,
correct?
a lot of people use that expression. You're not kind of working for someone. It's a bit like signing to a football team. Like you sign the contract and then you have to deliver a certain number of songs every year. So I had to deliver 10 songs a year. And something I try to explain to the students, I used to have to look at it as 1,000% worth of song a year. Because if I co-wrote a song with someone 50-50, that counted as half a song of my 10 per year.
Gotcha. Okay.
So if I, as I did, and I love co-writing with people. I think it's, I think it's great, and I've done it in lots of different ways. But that was kind of that's what I had to do. I did usually did way beyond that just because I loved it, and I still love it. So I mean, it fell into a couple of camps. It was writing songs with the artist. Now, some of those people would show up at the door, and we'd have a cup of coffee, and then write a song. Other people were people that I was kind of employed to play in their bands, and we struck up a relationship, and then we sort of went, oh, well, let's try writing a few songs. And most of the time that really worked. It kind of works better when you kind of know the person and you like them, you can hang out, and you get a sense of what they want. And also, I might have a new angle on things that they don't have, and vice versa. And that's the glorious thing about co-writing, is that you just, I know it's obvious, but you get something different, not necessarily better than what you do on your own, but certainly something different. And if I think about all the stuff I've learned about songwriting over the years, it's definitely been from writing with other people. And they'll do something completely different to what you imagine, but you go, oh, actually, that's really cool. Let's do that.
It'd be a pretty hard thing to, I think for people that are very new to the whole songwriting process and people are just getting into original music and whatnot, it can be quite a daunting thing. And I mean, I wouldn't class myself as a songwriter. Well, I guess I am to a degree because I've contributed music, and been credited for it. But it appears to be something that there's no strict formula or rule book as to how to start writing a song. So you have to on every occasion, and as you said, you walk in on some occasions, you can sit down and have a coffee, and then you can just get stuck into it. Other people, you've got to work a little bit more to get a bit of rapport going. And I'm sure you've had a few nightmares as well, where there's just nothing flowing whatsoever.
Oddly enough, not really.
Yeah, right. Okay.
Look, whether you came up with something great is different. But most of the time, you get to know them and you sift through all your ideas and you go, right, I reckon that you'd play them like three or four things. Now, sometimes it would be on acoustic guitar, sometimes it would be, on sequences or out of Pro Tools or something. And you go, what do you reckon? They go, nah, nah, nah. Oh, yeah, I like that one. And away you go. So you've already got something. And most of the time that would work. And creative people, strangely enough, when put under a bit of pressure can actually usually respond, particularly with a deadline. Some people would show up knowing they've got a flight in the next morning. So it's just like, well, we have to. And they've probably got a career they're trying to start. So they're kind of motivated. So most of the time it wasn't kind of like pulling teeth. It was like, okay, let's do this. And you wouldn't be the only one they're riding with. You weren't special. You were just another guy who Sony sent you to, which is fine. If you look at the credits on the last 5 seconds of Summer album, or the only one. There's a couple of guys in the band and then a bunch of other writers on every single song, and there's a different writer on every single song. So they would have done roughly the same thing, been thrown into a room and go, right, okay, hits please.
I guess it could be from a label point of view, it could be a little bit ruthless because it is a business to in a particular sense, to produce and as you said, if you've got a minimum or an expectation from Sony, who's contracted you to produce, well, not produce, but to create 10 songs, I guess there's a bit of pressure. I mean, it depends on who you've got lined up to work with as well, as far as how easy that is to fulfill.
Yeah. Well, there was one, woman who was at Sony at the same time as me, and she wrote 11 songs with this one guy. And it was all, he's about to sign to, a record label with three letters starting with E. And then right at the last minute, they dumped him just before they were about to record. And so she's invested, all this time. And, and that's the risk of it, is that he was going, right, that she would look at it and go, right, well, this is probably worth our while. So, I mean, there is pressure, but there's also risk, like anything in the music industry.
Nothing's guaranteed.
That bit's unpaid, like it's speculative. And it's a bit like a lot of the stuff we do, speculative, but,
Yeah, definitely. And was it something that you had to try and sort, like they give you a list of artists that are looking or need songwriters, and would that be your decision as to who you pick, or were you just given a pool of people that you had to definitely work with, like it was their expectation more so than your decision?
Oh, no, the professional manager, we'll call him, who's kind of like not the boss of publishing, but he's next in charge. He knows what I do and the sort of stuff that I do, and people would come up from other record companies, and it wasn't just so, all the record companies and people, managers would go to the publisher and go, right, we need some more songs. They'd listen to what this artist is doing and he'd go, well, I think you'd be a good fit with that person, that person, that person. So it was a bit like that. They didn't usually recommend, they wouldn't send some hardcore dance person to me because it's not, other people are better at that. And the other thing is, they used to remind me of this constantly, we don't need album tracks. Anyone can write filler. You know what I mean? They're not sending a songwriter to you because they need to fill the album up. They need someone to write a hit.
Yeah.
And that is hard, and that's, it's hit and miss. Sorry for the pun. Mostly miss.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because, how do you write a hit? I still don't know how to do that. Just write a great song is all you're trying to do. Yeah. I mean, there's something you can do. You can kind of go, well, man, you don't really want to have that intro go from in the half. What do you think? Should we maybe just cut that down a little bit? No, so I'm in the arranging stage of the song, but let's just make it really strong and let's not pat ourselves on the back too soon. Let's not rest until, we think it's great.
It's it is, as you said, there are certain things that are sort of do's and don'ts when it comes to writing something that's got to fit into that pigeonhole or that expectation that comes from a label or from the artist or whatever it might come from. But at the same time, I guess that final product, it's really going to be subjective opinion as to whether that's going to become a hit or not and how that's marketed and how it's received.
They don't know, but there's some things like we can all write really interesting music that you go, well, that's, that's a really cool piece of music, and we've all got albums that we love, and your favourite song is the one that goes and explores lots of stuff. But that's not necessarily going to, excite anyone who wants to invest money in you. And, but some of the, the ones that did work, particularly with some of the ones, there's a couple that I co-write with someone else, for someone else, if that makes sense.
Yep, absolutely.
So I had some people I was playing in bands with, and we go, well, try to write some songs and see if we can pitch them. And I wrote this bit of music, and this guy that I was writing with went, okay, this guy's looking for a song, let's try and shape the melodies and the chorus and stuff so it suits him, and it worked. He took it. So, it sounds, again, a bit contrived, but it's just kind of going, well, I like this guy's music, and it's like to have a song on his record.
Yeah, and I guess, it depends.
Because I'm a songwriter.
Yeah, and I assume it would depend on what sort of, depending on to what capacity it is and what sort of contract you might be working under, if anything at all. But being a songwriter and having, music getting registered through APRA and whatnot, that depending on where that song ends up, in what capacity can be quite lucrative if you do strike gold in the right sense. But I guess it depends on what, if you've been contracted for Sony ATV, that I don't know whether, how does that work from behind the scenes?
I didn't work.
Yeah.
I mean, I've been out of that contract for quite a while now.
Yeah.
Because, the world of publishing and records has changed unrecognisably. I'm not sure you're aware of that. I took their cut, but it was pretty reasonable. It was about 25%, I think, from memory.
Yeah.
And, you know, but they worked for it and I worked for it. And sometimes they got things right, sometimes they didn't. And sometimes I got things right, sometimes I didn't. So, you know, it was one of those things. But, you know, it was initially 3 years, then they extended it for three, then for another two. So, you know, the relationship was working well, but it came to an end and we all went kind of, okay, well, you know, we've done that. We got some cuts overseas and here and things, you know, but these things come to an end.
Yeah, absolutely. I think one thing that we've found, and Tim in our band has done a lot of, and I'm not sure the right term for it, but he works with another ex-member from the band that I'm in, and they do J-pop songwriting, and they get shortlisted for labels in Japan, and they haven't struck gold yet, but it appears to be something that once, and this could be similar to what you said before, as far as writing something and then pitching that song idea to the right people as a result of you know, you're going in reverse as opposed to the other way around. But if you do strike gold and it does get picked up, then, you know, it could be, there is a potential there for it to be quite lucrative from a financial point of view.
Yep.
But definitely appears to be, just from the outside looking in, quite cutthroat, and there's a lot of competition out there.
Oh, there is. I mean, there's a lot of noise out there. But, you know, it's good to have, you know, people around you who are willing to go in with you. And, you know, I had that with Sony for a long time, and, you know, even management, I mean, it's all kind of different now. I mean, publishers still have a role to play, but obviously the income isn't there that used to be there from publishing. I mean, there's other streams now, like, you know, getting songs on ads is, you know, another, and movies. I mean, it's always been around, but, you know, striking gold these days is having Apple pick up your song for an ad. You know, you're welcome. And even, I've forgotten their names, you know, Don't Hold Back, what's that song that's on the car ad? That's an Australian band, what are they called? Well, anyway, that's made them a fortune, you know.
Oh, is that the Jeep ad?
Oh, I can't remember.
No, I'm not sure, yeah.
But, you know, that's incredibly fortuitous. And, you know, then you've got bands like Empire of the Sun who, you know, have made a fortune from one song.
Yeah.
I'm sure their other songs are really good. But that one song is still going, you know.
Not a bad investment.
3 years later.
Yeah, return on investment's quite strong in that case. But I guess it's not something, I mean, it's good for, I guess, for artists and songwriters to aspire to hopefully get an opportunity like that. But as they are few and far between and there's a lot of competition, it shouldn't be a case of throwing all eggs in one basket, so to speak. I mean, there obviously needs to be a lot of other motives and ambitions behind why you're doing it in the first place, not just to try and aim for tiny little hole there that might not be available.
Oh, the day you sit down and go, oh, let's put that chord next to that. Oh, that's really cool. That's a long way from thinking, you know, right, what's the most strategic thing I can possibly do? You're like a 15-year-old kid at a piano going, just making this discovery that, you know, you can make music like the people that you like. But, you know, I mean, I never particularly saw myself as an artist, so I guess that's the difference as well. But, you know, there's people, and when I say artist, I mean someone who, you know, whose name's on the poster, which is another old cliche that managers used to throw at us.
I guess it comes back to what's the focus? What's the goal, the ambition that person has? Is it to be a rock star and make your parents or your friends at school impressed with what you're doing? Or is it a case that you just want to be able to be a performer, write music, perform music as a full-time income? And I think some people have a very, very much sort of a tunnel vision approach with what their dream is. It can get quite tragic when reality slaps them in the face.
Yeah. But I think that the hardest thing, it's a few hard things in terms of what we get across to the students, but one of them is to take yourself seriously. Some of them have this impression that taking yourself seriously as a musician and working really hard will suddenly take the fun out of it, or will remove the rebellion factor from being a musician, and it's just not the case. for every band that you see who appear to be, sticking it to the man. They probably rehearsed and they probably got their act together and they're probably really good to go on stage and break stuff and spang with people and hurl themselves into mosh pits. But they're probably still a really good business,
Yeah, absolutely.
Behind that.
Oh, it's like when years and years ago, there was a few people that I knew that that lived around the inner west of Sydney, and it's that cultural alternative hub of like-minded individuals. But there was this tragic element of where it was cool and whatnot to be a starving musician and sleep on a on an air mattress in the corner of somebody's house or whatever, and you did, and they just were repulsed by the thought of any sort of hard work or success because that would tarnish their image of being, this sort of starving muso. There was something romantic about it. And I mean, hey, power to you if that's what you want to do for the rest of your life, but those people tend to get quite upset when nothing goes their way.
Well, look, I mean, the other thing we talk to students about is what do you want to do? How do you want to get there? But also what level of success are you content with? Or what level of success is reasonable? I mean, two of the guys in 5 seconds this summer went to TAFE. Now, no one, I don't think even them imagined that they would end up doing what they're doing, but they certainly wanted it at the time or appeared to. And then, there's been other people who've tried stuff and it hasn't worked or have gone right. There's one guy who's not a kid anymore. He's a big boy. He came to us and he was a pretty good drummer, a good guy. But then, toward about halfway through the plan, we kind of went, look, I've got an opportunity to go and do a bit of crewing with a band. Do a bit of, drum teching. We went, good to finish your diploma. But, someone's not into it, so we gave him our blessing, gave him all bits of advice we could. And, 10 years later, he's called Chisel Drum Tech.
Yeah, right, wow.
And he still, says that going to TAFE was what headed him down that path, even though we didn't teach him anything about drum teching. But he was just learning about music and the music industry. So he came in wanting to be a drummer, but walked out wanting to be a drum tech and has gone on to do really well at it. So, it's one of those things. All students in an environment where they can see a bit of everything and they can hopefully work out where it is they want to go with it.
I think it's like anything in life, really. I mean, you can have a dream and a vision, but I guess you have to be open for changes and other opportunities that pop up. And sometimes I think when you've got too much tunnel vision on the one thing, a lot of fantastic opportunities get missed along the way. So it's good that, I guess, from your point of view, that a lot of the students are getting exposed to, I guess, a wide range of opportunities and options, and just to at least open that mind up a little bit that there are a number of ways to flourish in the creative world.
Oh yeah, I mean, some of them have not really been exposed to things like Pro Tools and Logic, and they're the main two bits of software we teach. And they kind of, until someone sat down and they spent a year and a half doing it, they don't realise that they actually got good at it. And then they go, okay, so there's a whole other thing I could be doing.
Yeah.
And the other thing is, we say to them, what do you think your week would look like once you leave? What are you doing each week? And I say one possibility would be you're playing a gig once a week.
Yep.
Another couple of days you might be teaching, another couple of days you might be doing another job, making coffees or something, and then in the meantime you're at home writing, and then what they have to kind of go, how am I going to do this? And we never suggest that people don't go out and get a job. We do reasonably say, if you're living at home with your folks, you don't need a full-time job, because if you get a full-time job, it eats all your time. And that's not a judgment. It's just like, well, that's just what happens. So, be strategic about it. Like, if you really want to do this, go and get a job so the pressure's off and don't leave you alone because you're not being a, hopeless millennial.
yeah.
But then, a lot if you, and you know, they don't necessarily think about this lantern, we call them. It's just like, if you're working somewhere for 3 days, that leaves you 4 days. If you write off however many hours you feel like sleeping, that's a lot of hours to throw into your music if you're really into it.
Yeah.
You know, it's plenty of time to write, to practice, to learn, to make connections, to beef up your Facebook page, whatever it is you have to do, whatever focus you've got, you know. And if they don't feel like working hard, then nothing we say is going to change that.
Do you guys?
And there's certainly been people like that who've come through.
Oh, absolutely. And are there things that you guys would teach the students to provide advice of how to structure their days and weeks? Because, I mean, it's not just stereotypically musicians; it's anybody when it comes to things like procrastination and losing focus and getting distracted ending up on autopilot and finding that you're scrolling through Facebook for several hours and not getting anything done. Are there anything that you guys do with regards to that? Or is it more of a case that it's really up to that student to work that out themselves?
I mean, apart from shake their heads, pull their hair out and look at them and go, "You're so talented, why aren't you doing something?"
Yeah.
I don't want to get into too much social commentary particularly, but we've certainly noticed a change in the student population since 2007, and collectively we have. Certainly not ability. We always get great people coming through. Definitely more distracted. Now, there's nothing particularly special about an 18-year-old's level of obsession with portable devices. It happens to everyone to the age of 70.
Mm.
So it's just we remember a time before that. Mm. And maybe we develop some habits of knowing, oh, I'm getting distracted, let's stop that.
Yeah.
But certainly the whole process of finishing something, and that's something we press, is actually finishing this qualification will help you get through life if you can get some habits that lead you to finish this qualification. Does that make any sense?
Yeah, absolutely.
It's like, well, okay, you know, I know you're getting distracted, but, you know, I can't give you this qual until you submit this work, and you can't submit this work until you finish it, and you can't finish this work until you start it.
Take the hint.
I'd like to think that there's some people who kind of by the time they get to the end have kind of grown up a little bit and have gone, okay, I really want this, so I'm gonna have to figure out some way. And there's plenty of people, you know, plenty of the students have got other things to contend with.
Mm.
Increasingly, like, you know, kids will go, you know, oh, I didn't make it this morning because I had to take care of my little brother.
Mm.
And you go, right, okay. Or, you know, I have to take my mother to the hospital. So I have to take his mother to the hospital every Wednesday morning. And he's going, well, you're supposed to be in class. He's going, oh, no one else can do it. She's broken a hip.
Mm.
And he's going, okay, all right. So, you know, it's a mix of being firm and sometimes a little harsh and compassion for wanting them to succeed and understanding that their life isn't necessarily easy and not assuming that they're just being lazy. But having said that, some of this lady.
Is there a high dropout percentage for you guys that come through those courses, like with the students, or is it, what's the completion rate? Even if it's not an exact just a rough idea.
There's oddly enough two separate things.
Mm.
There's people who who attend and participate right to the end, but then don't handle the stuff in.
Right, okay.
So it's the finishing factor. And they love it here.
Mm.
They love it and they really enjoy it. And you can see them getting better, but then they just don't hand stuff in.
Yeah, okay.
So completions and seeing it through the end, they're not quite the same thing. As far as the people who pay us, they consider them separate too. If someone stayed to the end and learned heaps but didn't actually handle the work in, they don't consider them complete. The student does and isn't necessarily that fussed about the piece of paper. Now, it's not all of them. It's just a minority.
Mm.
But, you know, there's definitely, like, we start with big numbers in Certificate 3 and then they shrink down in Diploma.
Mm.
And then shrink down again in Advanced Diploma because obviously it gets harder as we go up and we expect more. Look, I'm probably in answer to your question, we kind of lead from the front, and, you know, I have fairly low tolerance for people who are late all the time. Mm. And, you know, we tell them the truth. Like things like, you know, if you're in my band, I'll have fired you by now.
Mm.
Because everyone else is in the band has learned the song for today, but you haven't.
Yeah.
You know, it's not really fair on them, really. And no one's going to want to know. And then on an individual level, if someone just don't hand stuff in, you just go, well, you know, we don't, because it's TAFE, you know, and I don't, you know, we're, despite what people might think, we're under a lot of scrutiny, and we always have been. Like, we don't pass people that don't deserve to pass, you know. We're not motivated or not propelled by a need to make profit.
Yeah.
So, and, you know, we're subject to audits and all sorts of stuff. So, you know, and it's also really bad for the other students to see someone who's clearly not cutting it or not contributing or not doing their work and find out they pass. And people just go, all right, so this is a bit meaningless then.
Mm, absolutely, yeah.
And, you know, sometimes failing stuff is important, is good for people. That sounds like, you know, brutal or a cliche or something. But, you know, and, you know, sometimes millennials, and, you know, again, say this without an objection, when you actually say to them at the end, you know, that really wasn't very good, they look at you like they've never heard anything like that before.
Mm. Yeah.
And that's definitely something different in the last 10 years.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
You know, they just go, oh, really? and, you know, I've learned in the last 5 or 6 years, well, maybe longer, is just to go at the beginning of particularly performance class, go, anything I'm about to say is not personal. You know, if it's not because I like you or I dislike you, either way, it's because if you're out of tune, you're out of tune. If that last run through that song was really sloppy,
mm.
I'm just telling you it was really sloppy. So, you know, if we need to do it again, don't take it personally. It's just like, it's not there yet. And on the whole, they really appreciate that because, you know, they're not going to get any better if someone isn't telling them the truth.
Oh, that's right, especially straight from day dot. If you can get them into, or at least attempt to try and get them into the right headspace, then they're gonna produce a lot better over time, and at least yep. You know, a better chance of them completing the entire course and getting through all their studies and in the right way, as opposed to yep. somebody, as you said before, that might just casually come and go when they please and do things half-assed and create a bad impression on the rest of the students who are busting themselves to try and achieve.
Yep. And, you know, and the thing is, it is a network.
Mm.
So, you know, once they leave, you know, people go and form bands, you know, numerous bands in different sort of all sorts of areas once they leave. And if someone gets a reputation TAFE for being a bit slack, then that's a hard thing to correct. You know what I mean?
Mm. Definitely. It's going to be...
No one can be bothered.
That's right. Do you
Yeah, it's the old ad you see in rehearsal studios, nighttime wasters and wankers.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
you go, for God's sake, think of something else. But unfortunately, it's the truth. You know, must have own transport.
Yeah, must have own. That's right. You mentioned it before, and obviously it's very important from the perspective that you've got and heading a department and trying to upskill young people to be competent musicians and people that can work within the industry in whatever facet that may be. Because the music industry as a whole, and I'm talking very in a very general sense, when it comes to compared to other industries where qualifications and things are so in or can be very important and are acknowledged, in the music industry there appears to be not so much structure in that regard. So where those qualifications aren't always validated once you leave. So I guess what I'm trying to say is, do you find that there are people that come through that are trying to get a piece of paper and that's it, and thinking that that's what's going to get them to the next step, thinking that it works the same as another industry, as opposed to whatever industry out there, like a qualification, diploma and whatnot. But in the music industry, it just appears, and I guess it depends on to what level you're moving on to. But a lot of the times, those qualifications, it's more the knowledge that you're building from it, more so than that piece of paper at the end of it. If that makes sense, it's a very roundabout way of me trying to get that out.
No, exactly what you're saying. Yeah. No one's going to kind of put an ad up for a bass player, and then when they walk in, say, "Could you show me your ticket, please? Can I see your accreditation before you plug in?"
Mm.
We all know it's not like that. It's not like, if you want to be a dental hygienist, you need a dental hygienist certificate.
Yeah.
We're all aware of that. so there's lots of reasons, why people would want to come.
Mm.
It's certainly having a qualification opens up, some areas of employment. And again, if we're talking about, like I said before, what's your week look like? Having, a diploma at a minimum and advanced diplomas, in terms of teaching, is really, almost mandatory now. Most of the music shops, certainly in the Northwest, they want people who have a qualification in music. They just don't want that. It wasn't always like that.
Mm.
And it wasn't always like that because there wasn't somewhere to study. When I left school, there was the music degree I did, and there was the jazz course. There was nothing even remotely that looked like contemporary music, and certainly tertiary people didn't take it seriously, and in some areas they still don't. We don't, again, delude people that it's, people are going to need to see this. But what we do say is that, particularly those who didn't finish school, we kind of go, well, look, let's finish this. It says a lot about you to any number of people that you have completed something. The second thing is that you will learn heaps and you will have a better chance of making a living if you're better at this.
Absolutely.
Than you were when you walked in.
Yeah.
And it's very rare that people get worse after 2 years of us. Actually, that never happens. They ever leave. They get better. There's certainly some people who walk in and go, I want to be a music teacher. And they come to us and we've got an articulation with the University of Western Sydney. So they do their diploma, their arts diploma. They go straight into UWS second year and a bit, and then finish their degree and then go and teach at schools. Now, there's quite a few people who've done that. And some of them have said that from the beginning. You ask them in Cert 3, what do you want to do? Now, either they haven't got into uni or they left school early and this is their second chance to get in, or they see us as, I'm going to get some really practical hands-on stuff happening and then I'm going to go to uni and write lots of essays. And there's even been people who've done the degree and have said, I want to be a music therapist. There's currently like two of our advanced diploma graduates who are studying music therapy at UWS.
Right.
And that's really cool. I mean, it's like, I'm not here to tell people they need to be rock gods. They're here to study music and what they want to do, none of it's better or worse than anything else. Like if you don't want to go and, slam a bass with a pick every weekend, if you want to help people being a music therapist, then I'll do everything I can while they're here, but I'll have to help you do that.
Absolutely. And it's probably a good thing because it's probably like any industry, but especially in this particular industry, there are just so many variables and options out there and paths that people can go down. That is a huge positive. It can be quite confusing and overwhelming for young people trying to work out what they want to do. But it just shows that there's so many different things that or possibilities out there, especially if one particular path isn't the reality that they were originally thinking it was. There are just so many other things out there that you can still follow that passion and the underlying passion of music, but applying it in another particular way.
The other thing I should point out is that we don't just do music.
Hmm.
So we do sound production.
Yep.
And we do live sound. And I think it's the best live sound course in the country. It's fantastic.
Okay.
And we do music business and we do theatre and we do black and music theatre.
Hmm.
So when I say they get a view of what's happening, they get to see everything. We do two gigs a week so that, I've actually worked. I've shown up at gigs, and I've worked with literally a dozen of our ex-sound graduates as live sound and lighting people. You show up at gigs and there they are because they get work. And in some ways, that's where the most work is, working in live sound lighting, because if you think about it, you know, with all the changes that have happened, it's never gone away. A lot of people need a PA and lights, whether it be dance club or a gig or a corporate function or even a wedding or whatever. So, you know, and there's certainly been people who've shown up and started in music and gone, done, say, a diploma and then gone and done the live sound, and their week is a bit of teaching and they're either gigging on stage or they're gigging behind a desk. So, you know, stuff like that, that's really nice to see.
Oh, absolutely.
And they've been smart enough to go, okay, well, I can actually get two streams of income from this place.
It definitely breaks the old norms of people finishing school and then going into some sort of tertiary education or whatnot, and then going into a 9-to-5 job and that's it, and there's that one source of income. And I think that sort of brings, while it, an old school mentality of stability and whatnot, there probably is also a number of pressures and anxieties that come from relying on that one stream of income. Whereas I think now, and it's been around for a while, but I think it's probably more common now than probably has been in the past, where a lot of people sort of look at things as being more from a freelance point of view and contracting for a number of different areas, where you're not relying on just one thing to keep you going and keep you surviving. You're multi-skilled. You can dabble in a whole range of different fields, and if something dries up, then you can just move over to something else.
Yeah, it's just making yourself useful, really.
Yeah, it is.
To multiple people.
Yeah.
You know, and I think, you know, we've certainly had, you know, more than a few people who've, say, straddled running a studio and then playing live gigs. I mean, there's that combination, and there's people who've gone from playing live gig to running a studio and then doing front of house. I mean, there's been people who've developed, you know, and that's the great thing about it, you know, if you're motivated, and this is the thing, I mean, a lot of parents come up and say, will they get a job when they leave? And Andy, the other head teacher that I run the place with, his line is, do they have a job now? And they go, well, yeah. I said, well, they'll probably get a job when they're finished. And he's basically going, are they employable?
Yeah.
Are they, you know, he wouldn't say it, but, you know, are they a dickhead? And that's often, you know, we have to watch what we're saying sometimes, but occasionally you just go, well, the best bit of advice I could give you is get good at stuff and don't be a dickhead.
But, I mean, it's as simple as that, isn't it?
It is simple as that, because someone will go, and sometimes when they're, I mean, I do this as kind of a joke. So I write a chart on the board, big talent, dickhead graph. So it's talent up one end and dickhead up the other. So the more of a dickhead you are, the more talented you better be for people to put up with you.
You better compensate that in somewhere else, yeah.
That's right. Yeah. Or ideally, you want to have like 1 out of 10 for dickheadness and 9 out of 10 for talent.
Yeah,
and you'll be fine. But anything other than that, and if you head in the wrong direction, and this is a thing, and this is where you go, why are you late all the time? And why haven't you learnt the song? You know, and you just, if they don't get that message, then I'll probably never be employed by anybody doing anything.
Mm. It's really just putting the responsibility.
And if that's what they learn from us, that's what they learn from us.
Yeah, definitely. And I think there's probably a lot of... And it comes from an older generation and parents and whatnot, just that scenario that you mentioned before, but where I think a lot of people come of age and want to pursue something, but have a very romantic view of what they think music is, and probably not giving a lot of respect either for it being a legitimate profession. So a lot of people think that you might strike it lucky and be very on a famous scale, and then you can reap the rewards from that. But anything apart from that is not a viable option. So there's a lack of probably respect for what the entire industry is, or maybe not even lack of respect, but just probably just a bit of ignorance, not understanding what the possibilities are.
Oh, I mean, there's, you know, vast amounts of ignorance about the entertainment industry from people who aren't in it.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm vastly ignorant about how a lot of other industries operate. So I don't blame them. I have no idea about the in and outs of being a chef, you know, or whatever. But, you know, it is your job to dispel some of the things. It's also a job to inspire them and go, well, look, there are possibilities here, you know. But put what you thought it was aside and let's look at what it actually is and let's work out with the abilities you've got where your place in this is and then how hard are you going to work. I mean, obviously, Idol and X Factor and Australia's Got Whatever, but the other ones, there's another one, The Voice, have warped people's perceptions a bit.
Oh, definitely.
And, you know, I've got friends who teach at some of the larger private colleges and, you know, they have suggested that a lot of them are there just trying to get good enough to get on The Voice or X Factor. That's kind of, they think that's the one way to become famous, which is, you know, obviously a little bit sad and it's a bit annoying.
Yeah.
Now, I wouldn't necessarily discourage anyone. We do tell them the truth about those shows as far as we see it. And, you know, we've all known people on it. We've all known people that have played on it. And we know what the contract's like.
Yeah.
And we know what their priority is. But, you know, that's certainly, you know, the general public will see going, well, that's how you get famous now. And for, like, 7 or 8 people, it is.
It's, yeah, it can be quite a struggle. And, I mean, in some cases, you kind of feel sorry for the poor student who's coming through with, I guess, that pressure that's been put on by family because, you know, there's an investment of money and whatnot. And that scenario that you said, you went back, I'm just going back to what you said before, where the parents turn around and say, well, is there a job at the end of it? You know, because, you know, obviously there's money being spent, so we want to see that return on investment. And because it's, I think the responsibility as opposed to other industries where the certificate probably means a lot more and it probably guarantees a lot more employment in other industries, whereas in the music industry, it doesn't, it's not always that clear cut. In most cases, it's probably not. But it, the responsibility is definitely put back on that student to hustle and to use the things, the skills that they've been able to learn to find employment themselves. Like the onus is back on them as opposed to other industries where, yeah, you can be guided down a particular path in some, not all cases, but in a lot of cases you can get guided down a particular path where you're securing and guaranteeing employment as soon as you walk out of the classroom. So I think that's a stigma that probably a lot of parents are stuck with, and it probably puts a lot of pressure on the student to, and probably a lot of guilt there if they're not seeing that direct line into a cushiony job after the course has ended.
Yeah, I don't see a lot of guilt, per se.
Yeah.
But I know what you mean. Yeah, I mean, it's not like many jobs. You know, I mean, since the qualification of any sort is never a guarantee, and this is kind of what I've observed over the years, is that, like, the same work ethic we need out of somebody doing our stuff is the same work ethic someone needs for someone who's enrolled in an IT course. Yet someone's going to want to see a certificate for networking before they take someone on, but they still need to see someone who's willing to work hard and is vaguely organised and,
absolutely,
you know, easy to get on with. So all those same things that we need out of them, people need out of any job.
Yeah.
It goes back to the, you know, don't be a dickhead philosophy. You know. And, you know, I'd like to think that in most, certainly at TAFE, most people will go, well, this is what, and this is the other thing that we dwell on, this is what people expect from you if you want to do this job. You know. I've got a friend who does a lot of producing and managing, and he manages this band in Melbourne, and he said there's 4 of them and they all work on their band 6 hours a day,
right,
5 days a week. So if you think about the manpower being invested in that band, that's like, ooh, quick sums, what's 4 times 6 times 5, whatever that is. That's that amount of manpower being thrown at that act, you know.
Absolutely.
That's what you have to do. If you want to be an original band, like, you don't want to die wandering. Like, it may not work out, but it will definitely not work out if you don't do anything about it.
That's it. That's it. That it's just that that simple concept of putting the time in and putting the effort in, and at least increasing the chances of a positive result.
Yep. And the other thing, I know a lot of musicians who kind of gave it away at 30. It's just kind of that age, really.
Yep.
But, 10 years in the music industry leaves you with a rather wide skill set, gotta
It does,
say.
and
Everything from management to dealing with people to dealing with venues to getting yourself organized, schedules, all sorts of stuff. And I've seen a lot of these people go on to have, really successful careers in other areas because of the skill set they've got.
Absolutely. I think even without going through any particular learning pathway, just from purely from experience itself. I mean, I know for myself over the last 10 or so years being out there and dealing with all sorts of characters over the years, and from my point of view, doing a lot of sort of the band management and logistics and tour managing and whatnot, you come across all sorts of wildlife out there. And but it's for me, it's I've developed all these skills that I can apply, and while they might not be qualifications on a piece of paper, I've been able to build a lot of things that that I can use in other aspects of my life, and a lot of it's sort of based on conflict management and logistics and things like that. But it's I guess that's probably another great thing about the industry is that there are so many skills that can be learnt that can be translated into other areas of life, whether that be personal or professional.
And the other thing about the whole parent pressure thing is that, if that young person or even older person has been inflicted with the talent for music, that's what they're best at. Like, it's just the way it is. What am I good at? I'm not good at math, or I'm not good at drawing, or I'm not good at selling real estate. I'm good at music, or I'm good at sound. I should probably give that a go because that's what I'm really good at. So, I mean, what choice do you have to? And
Well,
some parents really understand that. They kind of go, well, and I've met a lot, don't get me wrong, I increasingly meet parents these days. We do geek outside of TAFE quite a bit, and they tend to come to those. And some of the parents are just totally supportive of their children. They don't let them sponge, but they're totally going, right, well, they want to do this, so I'm going to do all I can. Not kind of showbiz parents, but
Yeah.
and that's great. And like I said, other parents, you do kind of get the feeling that things are tough, and you see some good people leave because they go, oh, I've got to go and get a job. They don't go, I really want to go and get a job. They just go, I have to go and get a job. And you just hope. I mean, I had one student even last year, I won't name names, of course, who by the time he or she finished, their playing had just come up like 100%. Like, they were good when they got there. But with the combination of advice from not just me, but everyone there, like, they're on fire as a player, and it's going to spend the next 4 years doing an apprenticeship. And you kind of go, oh man, I've really said this to he or she. I'd give you a gig. Why don't you just give it a couple of years? But there's that pressure, and it's like, to have a job.
That's it.
And so, some people go, well, I have to do that, and other people kind of go, well, no, I'm going to pursue this and see what happens.
Yeah, it's getting rid of the old mentality of blue and white collared work, and there's a lot of, I guess, a lot of existing pressure out there for, at least in certain areas, from parents or just kids that have been brought up a certain way that so they feel that that's something that they have to do. But it's, I mean, I could only begin to imagine how frustrating that would be for somebody who's invested so much time and has come such a long way to then jeopardize a lot of that by going off in another direction and losing that momentum.
Well, just know they won't be happy.
Yeah.
But, you know, I really don't say that. I mean, I'm not judging these people.
Mm.
You just kind of go, oh, come on. You know?
Yeah.
You know, but, you know, some people are risk averse and that's fine.
Mm.
I get that. And, you know, and, you know, we'll just have to see what happens with these people. Absolutely. But, you know, if someone rings me up and says, do you know any good people, I will still recommend them.
Yeah.
In a heartbeat.
Yeah, definitely.
If I know they've got it and they've got the right attitude.
No, that's cool. And I think a lot of people that are listening to this, there are people that are sort of new to it all, and there's others that have been sort of DIY on their own accord learning as they go over the years, and some have been quite successful on their own paths, and others are sort of struggling as well. So I think there's a lot of things to sort of pull from this as far as just taking on a bit more responsibility and realizing that, you know, you don't have to put all your eggs in one basket, but you can still follow a passion and be happy and also make it viable.
And like I said, being organized and professional doesn't mean that it stops being fun.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. You're not going to lose any reputation.
No, you know, it's a little cliche, you can't eat integrity.
yep. That's right.
Integrity doesn't pay your rent.
That's exactly right. That's right.
But, you know, playing the right notes in the right order might go some way to do it.
Yep, definitely. I'm just conscious of the time. I was going to pick your brain a bit about Ice House, but
sure.
I'm not sure how much time you've got there.
No, I'm good.
All right, cool. So I won't spend too much time, but I just want to get a bit of an idea because of part of my extensive Google research. There's a few different bits of information out there that were conflicting. But have you been in and out of Ice House since the mid-90s, or been part of the band since then?
Do you want the truth?
whatever you're comfortable with disclosing.
No, it's fine. I auditioned for the band just before Man of Colours.
Okay.
And I was a rather young lad back then. And it came down to two bass players, both called Steve, and I was one of them, and he went with the other guy. So obviously that was, you know, very disappointing because I always liked the band.
Mm.
I think, you know, the Flowers album was one of the first ones I really got into. I remember hearing that for the first time and just going, what is this music? Because that combination of, you know, synths and as a story of Gibson and his voice and the way he constructed a song, I just went, this is great. And, you know, it was life-changing to a point. Yeah. But, you know, a lot of music you hear when you're young is a bit like that.
Yeah.
But having said that, he and his management then went on to recommend me to a bunch of other gigs. And if we're talking about, you know, how you sustain, you know, a career, you know, being seen is one of those things. So, but then in 94, I got the call to come and do some gigs. Now, by 94, it had come to the end of, like, the big years, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Like, it kind of peaked, and by the time 93 came around, he kind of went, right, okay, well, I'm having enough of this for the moment. So I did a charity gig, and then I did a couple of seasons of Berlin, which was Ivor Davies and the Sydney Dance Company. So that was an original kind of dance thing that had his version of covers dispersed through it.
Yep.
So he and a guy called Max Lane wrote all the music for them to dance to, and then every 10 minutes or so, we would play a cover.
Okay.
That he'd reinvented, like all the stuff he likes, like Psychedelic Furs and Talking Heads and David Bowie and Hip Hop and stuff.
Mm.
Oh, it was fantastic. I loved it. It was great. Like, you know, what a thing to do. And then between then and kind of, you know, 2007, he would do a variety of charity gigs and corporate things. And me and the old bass player kind of shared the gig. If the gig was in Melbourne, the other guy did it. If they were in Sydney or somewhere else, I did them.
Okay.
So that's kind of why it probably looks a bit confusing. It's kind of, you didn't do a lot.
Hmm.
So they kind of split the gig. But then when it came down to we're going to start again, he offered me the gig. So I've pretty much done everything since 2008, but bits and pieces before then. And then, you know, the last 5 years we've been doing sort of a national tour every year. And more fun than I can describe.
It's I didn't see you guys on this tour that's just gone, but I think it might have been end of January last year at the Enmore, and I saw you guys play, and
What did you?
yeah, and I think that was when it was. I'm pretty sure it was the end of January last year, and
Yeah, no, it would have been. No, I know those dates intimately because that formed the basis of the live record we did, a lot of that gig.
Right, yeah, and I hadn't seen Ice House before, but I love the band. I've loved the music and whatnot. So I thought, oh, I've got to finally pull my finger out and go and experience this. And I really didn't know what to expect because I guess there's a lot of stigma around, especially when you look at like the old RSL circuits and whatnot with the
Oh,
nostalgic
of
acts
course.
and whatnot. And so I went in there
Heritage act.
going, it might be a bit sort of a slowed down version, or in some cases down tuned and a little bit different to
No.
what we know. And I just my jaw was on the ground for the entire show, and it was just the most incredible display of musicianship that I've ever seen. And I mean,
Bye, you should get out more.
well, I like to think that I've seen a few shows, and I'm
No,
still reasonably young, but just how, I mean, to start off with how tight it was, but vocally across the entire band is just it's on another level. It's just absolutely incredible. And that was what sort of resurged. I was a fan already, but I think it just sort of refreshed my appreciation for the band, and even just being a musician, I sort of went home and went, oh, okay, all right. Well, next time we get together as a band, I think we might have to kick it up a notch and put a bit more focus in what we're doing, because it was just, I think it was sort of a benchmark of what a band really should be.
Oh, you've
And
been very kind.
yeah, all this gushing, but it was just,
Oh, well, look,
yeah.
I guess what I'd say about that is that, the band is certainly a lot more aggressive live than probably is on the record. And well, when all was said and done, I was written a lot of pop hits, but his love really goes back to the music that he grew up on, which is like Iggy Pop and David Bowie and the Sex Pistols and T-Rex. That's which is so, everyone, we dig in, and that's the brief. The brief is to dig in when required. When I say brief, I mean that's what we're all into. We're not there to, politely go through the songs. We're there to put on a show. And I've got to say, a lot of it comes down to Paul Wheeler, the drummer. Like, I've been playing with him for a long, long time. We've played in about 10 bands together. And I have a certain, I love playing with Paul, and he hits really hard. And he's what Ivor refers to as a dangerous drummer. Like, he does these fills, and you just go, you're not going to make it out the other end of that, are you? And he always does, but there's something slightly psychotic about the way he plays. And he rim shots every single hit, and he's just got this vibe. I mean, I've played a lot of great drummers, and he's certainly in the top two or three that I just particularly love, and we all love the way he plays. And he's a lot of the reason behind, the drive that the band had. And it's kind of like, once someone plays like that, you all lift with it. And when he's having a crack, you go, oh, I've got to keep up with this guy. So, and the management of the band has also had a lot to do with this because, I mean, when you come back, there is, like you said, there's this danger of going, oh, right, it's just a reunion tour, we'll make some money and disappear. Keith, Wells, the manager, kind of went, we're after repeat business. We're not after, we want to make people want to come back. So Ivor doesn't skimp on things like, great crew and great front of house and lights and vision and stuff. So it's not a case of just being a nostalgic act. We want to be an ongoing entity, which means we need to be great every single time we walk out. And that's the attitude. Now, we're not always great, of course, like any band. Sometimes we have bad nights and others. But, and Ivor's Ivor. Like, he's really good front man.
I mean, that in itself was surprising because I'd never seen him live in general or the band. So him in himself was surprising, but as you said before, like the whole band itself was, and you used the best word, it's more of an an aggressive approach to the songs, where there's just a level of energy that comes from the performance that just makes the songs come alive, instead of going through, reading off some sheet music and just following it through from a to try and keep as close to what the album was.
No, absolutely. And luckily, we've got every gig we do, there's another 10 songs we could be doing. So, there's a wealth of good material to work with. I guess the people, there will be cross sections to the, listening public, to think Ice House and think Electric Blue, and kind of go, oh, right, okay, that's what that band does. And certainly it's a, a pop song. But there's plenty of other stuff there that, lets us really get stuck into it, particularly some of the Flowers stuff. It's really old. I know most of it's really old, but it's still, great. And and it has a lot to do with the attitude of the band too. Like, we're not, everyone in the band's done a lot of stuff and is quite used to playing on big stages. And there's a guy called Michael Painter, who you
Yeah,
may have seen up there,
indeed.
who was a Sony act for a long time, and he's a producer in his own right. He's a very talented guy, and he's been a great addition, because apart from the fact he's under 30, which brought the average age of the band down enormously. He was a breath of fresh air, because, like, he was kind of like, young and keen, and had that thing that people under 30 have. And he's a great singer, and so he definitely lifted the quality of the vocal group, as you said. And Paul, the guitarist, is also, he spent a lot of years touring with James Rain and LRB and lots of other people, and the sax player, keyboard player guys. He was in LRB, and he was in Cat Soprano, and he's played with a bunch of other people. So everyone's done a lot of other stuff. And because we've all kind of been handpicked, if that makes any sense, he's managed to strike a good team. And it's not just us, like the crew. The people around the band have kind of got all the right people in the right spots, if that makes any sense. So, the crew, and just as important to what you would have seen that night as anything we were doing.
It's as I said before, and the stigmas around sort of reunion shows or doing the old club circuit, and that's about it. You could tell straight away from a production point of view that this was not something that was just going to go through the motions of ticking a
No,
box and getting a little
not
bit
the
of
vibe.
income coming in. Is it something that you mentioned before about management having a large part of it, and a vision of where the band's going? How much of that comes from Ivor as well, in the sense that from a, and I guess we go back to what we were saying before, where you sort of lose the not the integrity, but that stereotype around it, where is he very business minded and strategic about how he approaches all these things, or is it more of a case that
Oh,
he just
yeah,
surrounds himself with
absolutely.
the right people?
Oh no, he's no, he doesn't, sit around and go, whatever, look, you take care of the business stuff, I just want to play. He's not like that at all. He, it's definitely like, Keith will, strategize, but obviously everything goes through Ivor. And he's a really good guy to work for. Like, he's really respectful. Like, it's not, it's not a sort of, gushing praise sort of stuff. It's not really what this generation of musicians are like. It's more like a sporting team where there's like constant sledging backstage, and it's kind of fun, who can sledge the other person the most. But but a lot of musicians are like that. They're a bit kind of like, no one's going to be allowed to get too big ahead about any of this stuff. And that's
Absolutely.
another thing, either is not interested. He's not interested in anyone else or him behaving like a pop star. And I mean, the final decision rests with Ivor. And obviously, there's been strategies that Keith has come up with that Ivor's not been happy about, so we don't do them. But you know, where and when and how is definitely something that they both come up with or either agrees with. The piece really good. It's just really strategic. And we don't play a lot like we did every weekend from pretty much January through the middle of March, and then we'll do a couple of gigs and then we won't start again till November. So in that respect, it's kind of like, well, that's all we'll do, because if we keep going, it won't be so special when we come back.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that's a well-worn strategy. It's like, you know, don't overdo it. And because everyone in the band is doing something else, there's not that pressure to keep it going so the band can stay employed. Like, everybody else is doing something else.
And it probably means that you got a much better performance. I mean, everybody's a professional anyway, but you're going to get a lot more buy-in from everybody and a lot more productivity and performance out of people because that pressure's not there. So you can come in refreshed and energized from whatever else you've been doing in that downtime. Well, downtime from Ice House, that is. I mean, not downtime for everybody personally, but to be able to come in and be fresh and be able to step up and meet the expectations that you've all put on each other.
Oh yeah, I mean, once you start doing some good shows, you don't ever want to do a bad one again. You know, so it's kind of like, you know, again, we're not alone like that. You know, I mean, there are lots of bands out there who play great all the time. Like, they're not special in that respect. But, you know, I suppose, yeah, people do sometimes get surprised that a bunch of old blokes can still, you know, have a decent crack at something.
Oh, indeed. And
you know, we haven't given away that, need to, you know, smash it if you need to.
No, that's right.
Because we love it. We all love the band. We all love the songs. And, you know, we kind of like each other as well.
Well, that definitely helps. But what you said before, just really quickly about different eras of the band and what people sort of might identify the band with, you know, from a very sort of general sense. And yeah, okay, maybe that those late 80s hits and whatnot are probably the most recognizable and known. And you said, like, so the older songs are there in the Flowers era. To me, those earlier songs seem to, I don't know, I'm a fan of all eras, but the older songs seem to have stood the test of time a lot better than some of the stuff that came out in the 80s, especially translated to when you play them live as well. A lot of those songs have some real balls to them. And
oh, they do. And he was young and angry when he wrote them. Young and angry and intense, you know. And I remember when they reissued the Flowers album, came with this live gig from like 1981. Mm-hmm. You know, I was still at school when that came out. But you just go, wow, he's really intense, like, as a performer.
Yeah.
He's had to develop a different persona now that, you know, he's 50-something.
Mm.
I don't know quite how old he is. Because, you know, you can't carry yourself when you're, you know, that age than you did when you were 23, you know. So he performs a bit differently, but we still kind of, the songs are the same, those early ones. They still have that same energy, and we try and capture that. The most interesting thing that I've observed is that when we started doing some of all the corporate stuff and charity gigs, you know, in what I'll call the quiet period, which is like 2000 to 2008, it was all about, like, we didn't play Electric Blue. And eventually the, you know, the corporate people went, you know, can you play it, please? And then, all right. And it was all about those ones, because they were the ones that were like top 10 all around the world.
Yeah.
But these days, it's all about Great Southern Land. That song seems to have grown. And it wasn't even, compared to the other stuff, compared to We Can Get Together and, you know, Crazy and all those things, it wasn't as big a hit at the time. It was a hit, but it didn't go top 10 in the States like those ones did.
Yeah.
But it's the one that people go bananas about.
It's
seems to have crossed over into this other thing. And what is also interesting is that Ivor was very kind to trust me to mix and edit the live album together.
Mm.
And obviously that was also a team project, particularly between me and the guitarist, we, you know, had a lot of conversations and sent mixes backwards and forwards. And the most acute observations he made was the Great Sunland's a rock song now. And we play it like a rock song.
Yeah.
And everyone is just like, the distortion goes up, Paul beats the shit out of his drums. You know, I try and not be too flowery with the bass part and just slam down the eighth notes, because that's actually what works the best.
Yeah.
And that song is, and it's kind of weird. I think it's the people who've seen us before play that song like that are the ones that really look forward to hearing it again like that, because it's become this sort of anthem, smashed out rock song. But it's really kind of on record far more delicate and probably more subtle and more sensible, and, you know. So that's kind of one of the differences you notice playing it live, you know, 30 years later.
Mm. Well, it's amazing how timeless music can be. And in some cases, some music can date very quickly, especially if it's something, you know, that might be a little bit more pop in nature, depending on the era that it comes from. But, you know, there's so many songs that can just stand the test of times, or even get reinvented in a way to give them a second lease of life. And that's certainly a song. I've got the live album, and it's just, it's incredible. And one thing that I noticed straight away, and it reminded me of the show that I went to, it was the song selection in general. And a lot of it was sort of heavy on that sort of earlier era of the band, but then even the cuts off those more, those mainstream albums in the late 80s. The stock standard picks were in there, but not as heavy as I thought they would be. So I thought it was quite refreshing. It was really cool. And obviously to be able to sort of relive some of that and get that energy through the album itself was pretty cool.
Oddly enough, my favorite part of that record is the acoustic set, mostly because I'm not playing. I've got to play a couple. I'll play one and a half of them.
Yeah.
But, you know, what they did with Street Cafe, I think it's great.
Yeah.
You know, I think that's gorgeous. I mean, I really love playing the original version of it. But, you know, it just goes to show. I mean, and again, I either took a little bit of convincing that it would work. Not because he didn't have any faith in the song, but he didn't know if people would want to hear the songs like that. But, you know, it was that fabulous little bit of drama that you have at a gig, that you don't tell them what the song is, and then you start playing it, and they suddenly go, oh, my God, it's that song. And he, you know, brought the house down, because, you know, the singing was great. I mean, all those guys sing really well. That bit was, you know, that's, it was also kind of made that gig that you saw in, you know, the subsequent live album, was having that bit in the middle. I mean, it's not a new idea to have an acoustic set in the middle. No one's pretending we thought of that, because we didn't. Lots of people have done it. I'm seeing you two do it in the early 90s or something. But it just means that you've got a bit of room to move. You can kind of go, well, we've done some of those songs like that, and we've reinvented pretty much that whole bit. And then we can, you know, maybe be a bit heavier with some of the songs that were a bit light. We can probably throw a couple of the more obscure ones. There's one called Cross the Border in there.
Oh, amazing. Yeah.
Which I was never that familiar with. I mean, I knew it, but it wasn't necessarily one of the ones I'd listened to, and I was just a fan. But Ivor in particular loves playing that one. And, you know, that's just like this thing. It's just like this epic, you know, feat of survival to get to the end. Because it makes me slap. Makes me slap, and I'm not a big fan of slapping, but, you know.
It's an incredible song.
It's just, oh, yeah, and it's one of those things that you kind of, you do it because it goes for 7 minutes, you know. And you kind of go, when it's about to start, you go, right, I've got to, like, you know, not get through it, because it sounds like you don't want to, and you just go, right, this is going to be a thing we have to do. Like, we've got to, it's kind of the most intense 7 minutes of the set.
Yeah.
So, you know, you've just got to, like, you got to keep up.
All hands on deck.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, it's got the big audience involvement in the middle, and, you know, the dueling guitar solos and, you know, all that stuff.
Yeah.
No, my favourite moment on a live record is actually the two guitar solos in Walls, which is the first song.
Yep.
And it's great. It shows the two styles of the two players. Like the way Ivor plays guitar, he's a bit underrated as a guitar player, I think. He's really interesting guitar player. Like he doesn't sort of shred, but he's got a real melodic edge to the way he plays the guitar. You know, it has a lot to do with, you know, why we sound like we do live. It's his guitar playing. And, you know, people don't sort of talk about it much, but he, you know, works really hard on the sound. You know, all the guitarists do. They spend hours on it. I just go and make a coffee while they're getting the sounds together. Just go, here we go. All right, another hour on guitar sounds. Looking fine. Well, you know, just a bass player. But you know, it bears fruit. It's a mixed metaphor. That when, you know, the band plays on these guitars and front of house, it's one of those things. You talk about the team. You know, Richie, the front of house guy, is like just amazing. He will notice like one or two decibel change in a certain frequency on the guitar sound. If it's not right, he'll say, well, can we work on that for a minute? That's the degree of kind of, you know, attention to detail and wanting it to be great that everybody has in the whole thing. And whether it's great, I don't know, but we want it to be great.
It's well, as you said earlier, it's all about surrounding yourself with the best people out there, and it certainly comes across that way when from a visual and an audible point of view.
Well, I mean, it's not Larry, the tour manager, who also has a lot to do with this whole thing. He has this great saying: everyone will keep their job until they give you a reason that they shouldn't. And I keep remember that all the time, because, and that goes with, it's a really great philosophy. It's just like, well, you've got the gig until you give me some reason why you don't. You know, but it's more a collection of the right people, if that makes any sense. Like, who's the best bass player is, like, that's, you know, I certainly know bass players who can play faster than me. One of them works at TAFE. He's incredible. It's just like, I watch him sometimes just go, how do you do that? I should just ask him one day, how do you do that? But everyone in the band is the right person for the band, yeah. Both in temperament and the way they play and their pulse. That's how Keith described it. Everyone's got the right pulse for this band.
Yeah.
Like, you know, even something as dumb as playing eighth notes, and, you know, you could line 10 guys up to play eighth notes and each will play them slightly differently, and one of them will play it the way it should be played for that song, for that band at that time. And, you know, that's me at this point. And the same with the way Paul drums, you know, Ivor calls him our secret weapon. Because,
yeah.
You know, we've done a couple of gigs with other drummers who are really good, nothing feels quite like playing with Paul, playing those songs.
It's that chemistry, isn't it? And I like the term that you used about pulse, because that's probably one of the best ways to describe it is, you know.
Yeah, it was mine, but that was Keith. And Keith, the manager, is the bass player from The Flowers.
Yeah, right. Okay.
I should have mentioned that.
Yeah, right. Okay.
Yeah. So he stopped playing with Ivor after The Flowers, and Ivor obviously went to Europe and got a new band and stuff. But I mean, Keith kind of, I still think he's a really good bass player. I mean, I love playing his bass lines. Mm. It's a bit, you know, awkward on occasions. Just going, sorry, man, you know, I'm doing my best. But he was the one who kind of described it like that. He sort of, you know, that's what he's looking for, is for it to kind of, and when all is said and done, he'll just stand out the front and go, how does this feel? Despite all the technical stuff, all the technical things that go on to put this gig on, and there's many of them, you're just standing up there going, how is this feeling now? And, you know, sometimes gigs start off slowly, or sometimes, you know, we did some gigs, you know, a couple of places that should remain nameless, where for the first half of the set, the audience look at you like you're just going, you don't know what to do. They kind of looking at you going, you could think, maybe a bit overwhelmed by kind of movement and volume. And then at some point, usually Pat Sutherland, they'll stand up and you can see the relief on their faces going, oh, God, and we get to, and you kind of, and that's the sort of, you have to fight that feeling going, oh, this isn't going well. You just have to keep going, well, let's keep going, and hopefully
they'll respond eventually.
So, you know, but a lot of the times, you know, they just want to get up and they're in a theater and they don't think they can, and the security guards wandering around going, don't stand up because someone might complain on Facebook. That's the last thing we want. I couldn't see.
Yeah.
So you all have to sit down. You think I'm joking?
No. I've seen it. I mean, I've gone to a few shows, especially at the Enmore, where it's a lot of shows there. I've just noticed a lot more of an increase in seated shows. And actually went and saw Jimmy Barnes. I don't know, a year or so ago, and I was right up the front. And as soon as he got on stage, you know, the first couple of Rose just got up straight away and everyone moved to the front, and you could just see how many people got extremely agitated and stressed out because they were sitting down and everyone was blocking their row. And I thought, of all the people,
it's the age group too.
It is. And you just think of all the people that you're going to see a Jimmy Barnes show, that you could just sit there and have a pleasant evening and watch him just scream his lungs out. So, but on a completely different note to that, probably one of the roughest crowds I've ever been to at a show ever. That's sort of demographic. There's something in the air that night. I think everyone hadn't been out in 6 months, and all the cans of beer and bourbon were just getting thrown around the place. And it just,
you mean Barnsley at the Enmore?
Yeah, and I was. I thought I was one of the youngest people there. I thought, oh, geez, everyone's showing me up.
So... Oh, no, old people are very badly behaved on the whole. Look, I think what it is, and I'll probably have to end on this note,
yeah, of course,
is that there's a generation of people who grew up in the 80s and 90s, and their idea of a good time was to go out and see a band. You know what I mean?
Mm. Yeah,
and it's still their idea of a good time. It's like, how do I have a good time? And it's not even just nostalgia. It's like, what do I enjoy doing? I enjoy going and seeing bands and getting a bit pissed and watching a band. And that's not that people younger than that don't, but it's a different experience.
It is.
Growing up on festivals and, you know, a whole different variety of things that they find fun. But, and particularly people in their, you know, 30s, 40s and 50s have got money and to go and spend. And so they go and see a lot of gigs. You know, the Day in the Green thing is crazy.
Yeah.
But we did one in Mudgee with us and James Rain, who was really good, I should point out.
Yeah.
And a few others, Mark Seymour and Myriad Pictures, and there were like 6,000 people showed up. It's like, you know, and there are some youngs like there, but not too many, and they all got pissed and got smashed and got into it, you know. So that's because, you know, that's their idea of a good time.
Yeah.
Good on. You know, anyone who goes to, you know, or used to go to Soundwave, they will probably look back and go, in 20 years' time, and go, well, that was my idea of a good time, and it still is. I might go and do that when the Disturbed do their reunion tour.
Oh, that's it. It's a different generation again. But it was certainly surprising at the time. I sort of went, oh, geez, these people are really showing us how it's done. Usually it's, from my perspective, I thought it was the young hooligans that were causing all the trouble.
No.
We had a whole bunch of shirtless guys who were just all barely standing up and swirling wild turkey cans around the place. And I was just standing and going, wow, okay, this is pretty...
You don't feel the need to keep up with that.
I had no urge, but it was good to spectate. Well, on that note, I'll leave you go. Thank you so much, because this is far longer than I expected it to go, which is great. And one last thing, very quickly, are there any plans for any original sort of recordings for Ice House in the future, or is it more of a case of just keeping the live aspect of it going?
Look, I think the live thing will have a shelf life.
Mm-hmm.
Look, that's up to either. The closest we've come to something original was doing the Dub House thing. We reinvented all the songs in sort of loosely reggae, which was heaps of fun, but nobody bought it. So, look, not at this point, but you never know.
Mm.
I think he's got to feel there's a reason, and I think, like anyone, you've got to think, where does someone at his stage of his career, where does original music fit in? You know, is someone going to play it on the radio? Probably not. You're going to make a film clip, you know, and who's going to watch it, you know?
Mm.
So, I mean, he strategically thinks like that. So he'd be going, well, there'd have to be a reason for me to do this. You know, so, you know, we'll see.
We'll see what the future holds.
We'll see. Awesome. Yeah.
Well,
yeah, so never.
That's exactly
all right, mate.
Right.
No worries.
Thank you very much. And yeah, okay. We'll keep in touch. Thank you so much, team. Really appreciate it. Thanks for sticking around to the end. That was a lengthy one once again, but was a great chat. And as said at the start, there's some real takeaways there. And if you're a musician or somebody who's looking to enter into the industry, or you're already in there in a various number of capacities, there's a lot of great things to take away from that conversation from somebody who has a lot of experience in it. If there's anything of interest from that episode that you do have and you want to look into further, head over to andysocial.net to begin with. Hopefully I'll have all of the necessary links listed in the show notes there. But if there is something missing, or you want some more information on something that I don't have referenced there, please reach out and let me know, and I'll see what I can do to fulfill those requests. As always, get onto iTunes, rate and review this podcast. The more ratings and reviews I get, then the more professional and legitimate this podcast appears to be. And if you're using another platform, then any way to share or interact with these episodes is greatly appreciated and will certainly help bring this podcast to more people out there. Lastly, May 28th, Saturday, May 28th, 6 p.m., the Fun Room at Frankie's Pizza will be our podcast party, the Andy Social Social. Very casual affair. It's just an excuse to get together and have some drinks. Jordan from Frankie's Pizza has been generous and let me have utilization of the Fun Room, which is a small bar within Frankie's Pizza. And that will be from 6 p.m. and we'll have that for 3 hours before it's open to the public at 9. So come on down. Frankie's is open from 4 p.m. in the afternoon. So if you want to come down for a couple of pre-drinks, by all means, come down. I'll more than likely be there. If you're traveling from overseas or interstate and you're stopping by around that time, please reach out and let me know. We'd love to have you there and say hello. As the weeks get closer and closer to the date, I'll reveal more details. But as I've said in previous episodes, I'm not advertising this anywhere apart from these podcast episodes. It's up to you guys whether you want to spread the word or not. I am not terribly fussed. It's all about you guys that are listening, and just a great way to build a community long-term with this podcast. So anyway, enough of all that. AndySocial.net is the best point of reference for this podcast. All of my blogs, episodes, everything is there. Links to all of my social media platforms. But if you're interested, I'm on Instagram, Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, YouTube. Can't even remember where else, but I'm a bit of a social media whore, but fairly easy to find if you search for me. But thanks as always. Enough rambling, and we'll speak soon. Ta-ta. You're ready. You're ready, social.